Hi, everybody. Dennis Prager here. If you read one piece, and there are a number of good pieces, but if you are banished to a desert island and can only take one piece of writing on the George Zimmerman trial and the whole issue with Trayvon Martin, the one to take is by Charlotte Allen in the Weekly Standard, A Tale of Two Trials. Charlotte Allen, if I had not just endorsed Ben Carson for president, I would have considered you.
Well, I'm so flattered, Dennis. Here I am just writing my story, and I could be president.
Yes, that's right. Isn't that something? But yeah, unfortunately, yeah. I can't appoint one.
Too bad.
Yeah, it's a bummer. It is a bummer.
Although I might not want the job. It's a tough job.
It is indeed. Well, you did a tough job, and it's so terrific. I love the human side of these things. So before we get into the piece, when you wrote it, did adrenaline course through your veins? Oh, my God, I can't believe people say this.
Well, I just started collecting things, but my story is basically that there were two trials of George Zimmerman. One of them took place inside a courtroom and was based on evidence that was admissible in a courtroom, and the other one was essentially based on rumors, suppositions, and theories that were constantly presented as fact by members of the media, by commentators and reporters alike, not to mention politicians of every stripe.
Right. So in effect, what you're saying is there were two trials, but not just legally, factually.
Oh, factually. I mean, the facts were completely different. For example, there was this notion that was constantly came up in the media that that Zimmerman had stalked Martin because he got out of his... He supposedly disobeyed a dispatcher's order and got out of his vehicle. In fact, Zimmerman... It was already out of his vehicle. The dispatcher's tape makes that very clear, that he was already out of his vehicle. He mentioned that to the dispatcher, who said, well, you don't need to do that. He had walked a few steps and then was on his way back to his vehicle when the altercation with Martin took place. So, in fact, there was no stalking whatsoever. The other...
Wait. Before that, no, this is so important because this is the... Even those who don't think Zimmerman committed murder, callers of mine, think, well, look, I mean, you know, while it eventually did become an issue of self-defense, it was Zimmerman who started it. This is now received wisdom.
Oh, absolutely. And that he somehow provoked the conflict. In fact, the prosecution tried to introduce evidence of provocation in a jury instruction on provocation that the judge, who was not especially sympathetic to Zimmerman, rejected. So, in fact, there was no evidence. In other words, inside the courtroom, despite the best efforts of the prosecutor could not present evidence that Zimmerman had either stalked Martin or had provoked the incident.
I want anybody listening who thinks that Zimmerman, well, I don't care what your side on the verdict or anything, if you believe that George Zimmerman disobeyed the dispatcher, then got out of his car to stalk Trayvon Martin, please call, because I want Charlotte Allen to answer what you believe, to respond to what you believe. This, so again, the chronology is, he was already out of his car when he was told, we don't need you to do that.
And then at that point, he might have taken a few more steps, but he had turned around and was no longer tracking. He was no longer tracking Martin when that confrontation.
And then we have every reason to believe he was attacked.
That's right. In fact, it does appear from all the evidence, and in fact, from what the witnesses saw, nobody saw the first moments of the attack. What the witnesses saw consisted basically of someone who was wearing a black garment, a black hoodie on top of Zimmerman. So what it appears that happened is that Zimmerman was basically jumped by Martin. And certainly Martin gave that first blow that essentially probably broke Zimmerman's nose.
Is that in the same meeting as when they spoke to each other? We'll be back in a moment. Back to Charlotte Allen, who's written the article you need to read about the George Zimmerman Trayvon Martin trial. Of course, it's the George Zimmerman trial. And go ahead, Charlotte.
There's one more point that I'd like to make because I think it's so important. And that is that in the media and among commentators, there was constant emphasis on the proposition that Zimmerman was supposed to have racially profiled Trayvon Martin. We all know that NBC selectively edited the dispatcher's tape so that it looked as though Zimmerman was volunteering the fact that Martin was black, and that was kind of the first thing he noticed, when in fact the dispatcher had specifically asked him whether this suspicious character was black, white, or Hispanic. Secondly, there's the matter of Trayvon's hoodie, which I didn't go into in detail in my article. But, in fact, that was supposed to be racial profiling as well, because young black men wear hoodies, and Zimmerman was supposed to have found Trayvon Martin suspicious because he was wearing a hoodie. When, in fact, again, it was a response to a dispatcher's question, what is he wearing? And that's when Zimmerman said, a black hoodie. That's the only time that the hoodie ever came up in testimony at trial, except in the testimony of one of the witnesses who noticed a man with a black hoodie on top of the man wearing the red sweatshirt, which Zimmerman was wearing. So, in fact, the whole business with the hoodie has now become a kind of cult item in the press and among Martin supporters.
I don't understand. Am I racist if I think I don't know the color, but I detect a male walking around at night in a place that has had multiple burglaries, some of which I personally witnessed. I've been asked by the housing association to watch, to be a guard, as it were, to be a watchman. And of course I would have a reaction to a solo male with a hoodie on. I don't know why we need to defend ourselves against that charge.
Especially when the dispatcher had specifically asked Zimmerman what this man was.
What if he would have said there's a kid with a hoodie on that I'm watching? Well, I don't know why that reflects poorly on Zimmerman. If there's a kid in a tuxedo, he would have said, or first of all, he probably wouldn't have reacted that way. And that makes sense.
Yeah, he probably would have thought that he was on his way to an orchestra or something.
Or back from a wedding, yeah.
In fact, he never volunteered the information. I mean, even if, you know, we don't even have to go to that hypothetical, whether it was reasonable, because he never volunteered.
All right, listen, I this is the most important, I think, is, number one, there were many important. By the way, you point out how the press manufactured different weights, how much they weight. Wait, we'll get to that in a minute. It's just, that's why the article is so important. But I just want to understand for me. So Zimmerman is already out of his car is walking around when told, we don't need you to do that. We didn't get out of his car a second time. Is that correct?
That is absolutely
all right.
Correct.
So now, when had they said to one another what Zimmerman claims? What was it you're looking for trouble? When did that happen?
That is a sentence from the dispatcher's tape, which I don't recall that because I just focused on the interchange with over Martin's appearance and over where Zimmerman actually was at the time. But I can't answer that question, unfortunately. I'd have to take a second look at that.
All right, because I want to understand, were there two meetings between them, in your understanding, or one?
Between Martin and Zimmerman?
Yes.
In my understanding, there was exactly one meeting that they did not speak to each other until the meeting that was followed or consisted of the attack by Martin on Zimmerman.
And the alleged words, I'll say alleged because nobody recorded them, between the two of them about looking for trouble.
Yeah, exactly. Yes, yes.
Okay.
Exactly.
I am actually continuing to speak with Charlotte Allen, who writes for the Weekly Standard. And though the verdict is in and it's considered quote-unquote history, it's really not yet history because of the passions that have been inflamed by the Trayvon Martin, George Zimmerman tragedy that took place in Florida. And so she has written this compelling piece showing how we have two narratives of facts, not just of perception, that of the media and that of the trial. And I want to give some examples here. I had mentioned to you, Charlotte, that you make a point that I had not realized, showing, for example, that on on Salon, one of the most widely read online magazines, as it were, a University of Colorado Boulder law professor, Paul Campos, described the quote-unquote scary Zimmerman as a 230-pound 30-year-old. How many pounds did he actually add to Zimmerman?
He added 45 pounds to Zimmerman's weight. Zimmerman, according to the police report filed at the time of the incident, weighed 185 pounds. Now, he did get heavier as he...
Right, but that's irrelevant. That's
totally irrelevant.
Absolutely. Wait, I just want people to understand then. I mean, I call it the L word because I consider it so horrible that I try to use it as an accusation very rarely, but it would seem to me that the law professor lied.
Well, I mean, yeah, he did it in the context of a hypothetical, which, you know, might make it one step away.
But the hypothetical has to be based.
Yeah.
It's not, he didn't say, if Zimmerman weighed such and such.
Yeah.
So he gave.
He did play very fast and loose with the facts. I mean, he also described Zimmerman as being 30 years old to make him as old as possible when, in fact, he was 28.
He calls him a 230-pound 30-year-old when he's a 185-pound 28-year-old.
Yeah.
And then Trayvon Martin, he took 10 pounds off.
That's right. Martin weighed 160, and Campos describes him as weighing 150, of course, to make him as scrawny as possible. And then Campos never mentions the respective heights of the two men, that Zimmerman was 5'8", whereas Trayvon Martin was 6 feet tall.
That's 4 inches.
So, yeah, that's a big difference.
Yeah.
So, but of course, that doesn't come into play because he's obviously trying to make Martin look as weak and helpless and childlike as possible.
CNN commentary, you point out, Roxanne Jones calls Trayvon Martin a child.
Oh, yeah. Well, you saw that everywhere in the media. They were constantly referring to him as a child, a 17-year-old. A 6-foot-tall 17-year-old as a child.
I will go through the accusations or the descriptions of the media and your response. Zimmerman stalked Martin. Go ahead.
And my response is that there was no evidence of stalking. As I said in the first segment, Zimmerman got out of his car I think he ran after, and Martin was some distance away. I can't remember how far, but he was not close. So Zimmerman started running in his direction, and then he told the dispatcher that he was out of his car. The dispatcher says, "That's we don't need you to do this." So Zimmerman maybe runs a couple more steps and then turns back, and he's on his way back.
How do we know he is on his way back to his vehicle?
Well, partly because of the his conversation with the dispatcher, and it seems clear from his breathing that he had stopped pursuing.
Well, that's very important. So we actually have physical evidence.
Yeah, that's the physical evidence. I mean, otherwise we do have only Zimmerman's testimony, but we have the evidence that he stopped, that you could not hear that heavy breathing that he was engaging in while he was chasing Martin.
Next one that you deal with, we already dealt with, that is that he disobeyed the dispatcher's order to stay inside his car, but in fact he did obey it, and was on his way back by all.
Yeah, not only did he obey it, but as a dispatcher testified at trial, he said, we never tell people what to do. So he just said, you don't need to do that. He was basically giving advice to Zimmerman, advice that Zimmerman followed, by the way. So there was no order to be disobeyed. So, but again, you know, you heard all the time that Zimmerman was a vigilante, that he refused to take police orders, that he was a wannabe cop who wanted to play cops and robbers and so forth.
I'd like to take this call here because we had a call from William, I don't remember which city, who said, you know, why didn't he, if he felt so threatened, why didn't he flash his gun? We have quite a number of people calling on that. Let's take one of those. Jamie in Nashua, New Hampshire. You're on with Charlotte Allen and me. Hi.
Well, good afternoon, Dennis. And,
hi.
Good afternoon, Charlotte. I called before the top of the hour. I live in southern New Hampshire. I'm a concealed firearms license holder. And, you know, to carry out that responsibility properly, you should know the laws, not only of the state in which you hold your license, but all the states that recognize your license. And there are about 30-odd that recognize the New Hampshire license. There isn't a state in this country that allows firearms ownership or concealed or open carry permits where it would be legal on nothing more than the suspicion that a person is, and I think the quote was, this guy's nothing but trouble or he's up to something. You'd be breaking the law if on that alone you were to draw your firearm and tell that person to stop. The police agencies, policemen, sheriffs, they don't ever do that, I mean, when they're following the law. So certainly no civilian firearm, a civilian with a firearm would ever be allowed to do that.
Well, thank you. I think that answers William's question. I thought I had said that, but I don't know as much as Jamie in New Hampshire does. But I said you can't just do that. It's obvious. You can't just show a gun because you're suspicious that somebody may be up to wrong. And the which I think is in Zimmerman's defense. I think. Go on. I'm sorry, Charlotte.
I would say that Zimmerman was acting very prudently and that he had no intention of using that gun until Martin was on top of him and basically pounding his head into that sidewalk. It seemed that at that point he really felt that his life or his health was in extreme danger, and then he drew that gun.
Brian in Tampa, Florida, Arthur, a retired police officer in Allentown, Pennsylvania, and a man who just hung up, all are making this point. And I thank you all very much. I just wanted to take one to verify you are not allowed, and quite properly. I mean, you know, flash a gun whenever you want. I mean, it's not a Western, 1950s Western. So obviously that's not. Your article describes a press that was so out of control, that was so aching to show this as a pure example, another one of white racism. I had made the point from the beginning. I noted the first day when the New York Times called Zimmerman a white Hispanic, that they were doing everything they could to manipulate the way in which they relayed news to portray a picture of racism.
Yes, well, I think that what happened was that the press developed a narrative long before anybody really knew any facts. They had no idea what Zimmerman looked like. And the story that had been put forth by the lawyer, Benjamin Crump, for Martin's parents was that Zimmerman saw Martin and drew his gun, just like William said, drew his gun and, in fact, fired two shots. That was the early story, was this man had seen this suspicious-looking black kid, taken out his gun and fired two shots at him. Then it went, you know, once the second shot, it became clear that there was no second shot, then it was one shot. So they had this narrative, this white man, white enclave of townhouses, which it was not, and drawing his gun and shooting this black kid just for walking around.
Where do you live, Charlotte? I don't mean your address. Where do you live? Washington?
I live in Washington, D.C.
I see. I was curious. Okay, good. Listen, I want to thank you both for your time and your great work. So much appreciated.
Okay, well, thank you, and it's been good to be on here.
You're very welcome. The article is up at DennisPrager.com. You might want to send it to friends. It's very calmly written, but I think it's quite significant.